We welcome you to Miles Chapel Baptist Church, located at 3911 Dickey Mill Road in Mevin, North Carolina, where the pastor is Pastor Scotty Terrain, preaching a powerful message that will definitely bless your heart and soul. The church vision is impacting, transforming, and empowering people's lives for victorious living. Yes, this church designed for you in mind. Well, the pastor is Pastor Scotty Terrain, preaching a powerful message every Sunday morning. Yes, the church location is 3911 Dickey Mill Road in Mevin, North Carolina. The telephone number for prayer, information, or directions is 578-1450. Make sure you come out to this awesome church where the pastor is Pastor Scotty Terrain of Miles Chapel Baptist Church, located again at 3911 Dickey Mill Road in Mevin, North Carolina. Now get ready for a heavy word of God from Pastor Scotty Terrain. Get ready for the word.
Demons tremble at that name. The name of Jesus. High blood pressure is regulated at that name. Jesus. Can we go ahead and be real with it? Cancer has to dry up at the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Jesus. Jesus. You know, that's the most sincere prayer that some of us have ever prayed. One word. Jesus. You didn't have time to get all flowery and pretty. All you had time to do was call on the name of Jesus. But the report is when you called him by his name, he showed up and answered your situation. Jesus. Sweet Jesus. Amen. Amen. Certainly before we begin, I do want to, by way of testimony, of faith strengthening, to acknowledge that Sister K. Morrow is in the building today. Yeah, boy. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. That's the kind of God we serve. When you call on the name Jesus, you get results. Oh, Lord. I thank God for doctors. I thank God for medical advancement. But when you know the healer, she has to love the Lord, because I told her, I said, ain't no way you're supposed to have been through all you've been through and come in here cute. How you do that? Why they do that? We serve an awesome God who will walk you through fiery situations and smoky destinations. And when he gets you through them, you won't look like what you've been through. Yeah. Y'all know that testimony that we don't want to share in church. That one? Yeah, that one. He'll bring you through it. Amen. He'll bring you through it and make you the better for having gone through it. Amen. Amen. Certainly want to acknowledge Judge Robinson. Thank God for you. Amen. Glad to have you here visiting Mom. Amen. 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 She's keeping me straight, just so you know. She's keeping me straight. Amen, amen. But I'm glad she feels she has that liberty. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, let's turn in your words to Matthew, the 15th chapter of Matthew.
I don't mind waiting, I don't mind waiting, I don't mind waiting for you, Lord, I don't mind waiting. for you, Lord.
Come on, can you help me say that?
I don't mind waiting. I don't mind waiting. I don't mind waiting on you, Lord. I don't mind waiting. I don't mind waiting. I don't mind waiting on you, Lord.
21st verse of the 15th chapter reads, then Jesus went out from there and departed to the region of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came from the region and cried out to him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed, in the New King James translation. But he answered her not a word. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries after us. But he answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep, the house of Israel. Then she came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, is it not good? It is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to the little dogs. And she said, yes, Lord. Yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire. And her daughter was healed from that very hour. I want to talk from a thought of a nameless mother with great faith. A nameless mother with great faith. Father, we thank you for this time, these your people, this your word. Ask God that you would use me, that you be glorified. Speak to your people. Share with them that they need for today and for this coming week. Strengthen them now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. And I certainly do. I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge Deacon Russell is with us this morning as well. God has blessed and strengthened him to be here. Amen, amen. So God is doing some things now. Amen. That's why we're going to keep praying, because he answers prayer. Amen, amen. That was a study by attorney Michael Minton on the monetary value of a wife's or mother's services in the home. First, he listed various functions that she performs. She's a chauffeur. She's a gardener, family counselor, maintenance worker, cleaning woman, housekeeper, in some instances, a cook, errand runner, bookkeeper, and an interior decorator, to name a few. But caterer, dietitian, secretary, and hostess. And using this impressive list, in today's labor market, he came up with that she should be paid approximately $52,000 a year for all that she does. Mm-hmm. Brothers got real quiet right through there. Let me go ahead and get some brownie points while I got the mic. And I'm going to say that's a little low for our house. You worth more than that, babe. No shame whatsoever, I know. The University of Michigan has conducted a nationwide survey several years ago, in which they asked thousands of girls between the ages of 11 and 18 what they would like to be in their adult life. And surprisingly, 80% expressed a desire to be like their mothers. Mm-hmm. It has been said that no other force in the life of a son is as strong as the influence of a mother. But if we look around in society and we see what's going on, there are pressures on mothers today. Wow, the mamas didn't even say anything. There are pressures on mothers today, and they're growing even greater. It's got to be the toughest job in the world just to think what is expected of her in this success-driven society. She has a successful career. She keeps the house spotless. She's expected to raise perfect children. She's expected to be a great cook. She's expected to look like a model and expected to be a charming hostess and a conversationalist. That's a challenge. That's pressure. If you don't know who you are and you don't know what God has gifted you with, that will run you out of your mind, sisters. You have to be confident in who God has made you to be. Amen. So if you ain't a cook, ain't no need of spending 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours up in the kitchen messing stuff up. That ain't your talent. Do what your strength is, and I pray you marry the brother that doesn't mind getting in the kitchen. Okay, all right, yeah. See, this notion of that it has to be one way or the other has got to go. Amen. Brothers, if you can't add 15 cents and 20 cents, give the checkbook to your wife. Ain't no need of having bounce checks running all over the place when you got somebody that's capable of doing it right there in the house. You just shift. That was for free. This ain't even Father's Day. Come on. You got to do what works for your house. You can't look at my house and try to govern your house. You've got to look in your house, sit down with your spouse, your wife, your husband, and determine what's going to work at your house. Many of us are in trouble right now because we've been looking over the fence at the Joneses, and we over here trying to do what the Joneses have been doing, and we don't know what price the Joneses have to pay. We don't know what happens in the Joneses' household when the doors are shut and the lights out. We don't know anything, but we want to be like the Joneses. Question, who are the Joneses anyway? I mean, not them Joneses. They good. Them Joneses, they good. They good. They don't have a fence. That's the other Joneses. Yeah, not them. They good. They good. They're solidified in who God has made them. Amen. Amen. There are pressures on mothers today. There are pressures on mothers. But this thing of pressure on mothers is not a new concept. Eve was blamed for the original sin and had one son who killed his brother. That's pressure. Hagar, Abraham's handmaiden, who was given to him, had a son by him, was sent away by him with her son, and almost died in the desert. That's pressure. Jochebed was the mother of Moses. Egyptians were killing all the male Hebrew babies to curb population. She places her son in a basket and lets it loose on the river. That's pressure. That's pressure. When your fight is whether to hold on or to let go, and you feel the best you can do for something that you love is to let go, that's pressure. Mary, the mother of Jesus, pregnant, there's no room in the inn for her, had to flee to Egypt to save her son's life. Now he's missing. As they're traveling, they go back and find him in the temple, and then she stays around, and years later, there is the trial and the crucifixion. That's pressure, y'all. But also, the mother in our text this morning is under some pressure. Her daughter is demon-possessed. Her daughter is going through some issues, and you never know pressure, you never know pain until somebody you love is going through something that you want to alleviate them of, and you have no power,
You have no control. You have no authority. You all you can do is pray and hang on for the ride with them. Have you ever known a person whose character could be summed up in four words? Great is your faith. Everybody doesn't get that. Because in order to have that spoken over your life, you've got to go through something. You've got to be at some dead ends and stand and declare what God said. You've got to be in a place of aloneness, not loneliness, because he will never leave you nor forsake you. But when it's only you and the world has turned against you and you're faithfully standing and saying what God said, then you can have that spoken over you. Great is your faith. Because faith can never be quantified until it has been tested. It's very easy to walk around and say, oh, I got faith. I have faith. I believe. But until it is tested, it is merely words. Those are just words that roll off our lips. And there are times when God hears what we say and he says, not that he needs to know because he already knows, but he needs us to know exactly where we are. So he allows us to go into situations and circumstances that show us just how faithless we are. Great is your faith. She was a Canaanite woman, came from a country in north of Palestine, a country that was hostile to the Jews, and she was presumably married, and she had at least one child, but that's all we know about her. Doesn't tell us what her resume read, doesn't tell us where she matriculated, doesn't tell us anything about, doesn't even share who she is. But isn't that just like a mother? They're not so concerned with them. They're not so concerned that you know who they are or what they've been through, but they are stretching, reaching, trying to get a blessing for their children. So in this single encounter with Jesus, he says to her, great is your faith. Only four words, but they were enough to enshrine her as one of the greatest mothers of all time. And these four words tell us everything we need to know. We can trust them because they were spoken by Jesus. And he is an expert on faith. The Bible tells us that he searched for it as a gem collector searches for jewels. And when he found it, he was filled with joy. He didn't always find it in his disciples. He didn't always find it when he was hanging out with Peter, James, and John. But here it is, this sister who's not even a Jew. She's from a Canaan. She's one of the Canaanites. She shows great faith. Well, Pastor, how does she show great faith? I'm going to share with you, and then I'm going to get out of here because we're going to eat today. Right here, and we're going for it today. First thing she does is she crosses barriers for her child. She crosses barriers for her child. She is a woman. By virtue of society in this time, she should not have even been out addressing Jesus. But she understood that if anybody was going to be able to do anything, it had to be Jesus. And if anybody was going to get to Jesus, it had to be her. Sir, I need to get to you because my daughter is this demon possessed. Not only was she a woman, but she was a Gentile. She was not a Jew. So she's a double outsider already. She's a woman and she's a Gentile. But she made up in her mind that she was going to Jesus to get what her child needed. She was a Gentile. She was a Canaanite. Her origin was from Canaan. She was from some of the leftover people who had not been cleared out when Joshua went through and conquered the land. There were certain folk that they didn't kill all of them out. And so here we see another one of these people popping up, these Canaanites. This woman has strikes all against her, but she made up in her mind that it didn't matter what barrier that she faced. She was pressing through. She was going over. She would crawl under if she had to, but her daughter was demon possessed and needed deliverance, so she was on her way to see Jesus. Now, I don't know about you, but I would suspect that there are some mothers in this church this morning who've had to go the extra mile, who had to reach, had to go without so your child could have laid awake at night crying, praying to God that he would bless your child, even in spite of blessing you. I just came by to let you know that whenever you press across circumstances, whenever you press across barriers, you've got to know that he will meet you there. He'll meet you there because there is faith in the press. Because if you didn't think it was better on the other side, you wouldn't keep pushing through. If you didn't think it was better, you wouldn't keep getting up. If you didn't think it was better, you wouldn't keep praying. It's faith in operation, and he responds to faith. Here was a mother who's in need. She's prepared to cross any obstacle that comes her way. But she's got to get to Jesus. Faith still requires that we make effort to cross whatever shows up in our path. Because you have to understand, a lot of times, confirmation that you are on the right track is that barriers do come up. Y'all remember the analogy we walked through with the football and the running back? And as long as the running back is going in the wrong direction, nobody will tackle him. Nobody will try to pull the ball out of his hand. They'll let him run free. But when he turns and starts going toward his goal, then you got these linemen that start hitting him. You got these defensive backs who are trying to strip the ball simply because it's confirmation that he's going in the right direction. Can I help you? Your obstacle last week wasn't to take you out. It wasn't to shake you up. It wasn't to mess your family up. It was confirmation that you're going in the right direction. It's confirmation that you still have faith. It was confirmation that you're moving where God has called you to be. What barriers are we facing now? I'm glad you asked. The barrier of time. Often we're too busy with things of the earth to pay attention to spiritual things. Then there's the issue of trusting one who lived over 2,000 years ago. There's a time gap. We can trust what we can see, but when it comes to trusting what we don't see, sometimes we become a little hesitant. The barrier of culture. In this day of modern technology, we often wonder, does God really understand the problems I face in this world? And what about the politically correct society that we live in? Christians are often accused of being too exclusive. But can I help you? If you line it up with the word, it is what it is. They call you what they call. They talked about Jesus. So why do you think they won't talk about us? I'm tired of everybody being able to do what they want to, say what they want to, when they want to, and as soon as somebody stands up and says, Jesus, now we got a problem. I had to share with some folk, wanted me to come and pray at an event. If y'all don't want it closed in Jesus' name, I'm not that guy. I know who saved me, I know who delivered me, I know who keeps me, I know who's blessing me. And so if I'm going to close a prayer, it has to be closed in Jesus' name. Now, you do what you got to do. You pray like you got to pray. I'm talking about me. I'm going to finish in Jesus' name. So if that ain't what you need, he said, that's exactly why I asked you. I said, all right. Another barrier, pride. Maybe the greatest barrier of all. Too many people in the church now are like folk who are drowning, but refuse help. They prefer you pour water on them. If you're hurting, you're just hurting. Sometimes we get so spiritually deep that we're no earthly good. Oh, I'm not claiming that. I ain't claiming it. If he left, he gone. You ain't got to claim it. He gone. Okay. All right. I feel a pull here. This whole thing of I'll never be broke another day in my life. What? If we got it all together like that, what is it that God is really doing in our lives? Because the testimony of God being in my life is, even though I'm broke, I'm still getting everything I need. Everything has been supplied. The testimony is, although he walked out, you still taking care of the house. You got the children looking good. They're still advanced. That's the testimony. Don't come in with this madness about, come on, y'all. What do we believe, really? It's frustrating because you see people who are hurting who can't acknowledge that they're hurting because somebody told them, if you really saved, you ain't supposed to hurt. The devil is a lie. Get back on target here. Okay. Listen. We have to understand. We are not exempt. We're not exempt from going through things. We're not exempt from having issues. We're not exempt from having problems. We're not exempt from having children that acting like they ain't got no sense. We're not exempt from all the things everybody in this life goes. We are not exempt. But we are covered. So what you need to say is, regardless of what I'm going through, he still got his hand on me. Regardless of how I feel right now, he's still going to bless me. He's still going to deliver me. He's still going to bring me out. I understand that the deadline is coming up, and I understand I've got more papers than I've got time, but I'm still proclaiming I'm going to get through this thing because he's made an investment in me. So, what exactly was it that drove this mother across these barriers running to Jesus? First thing was desperation. She knew that she wasn't going to be able to do it by herself. She knew she couldn't fix the problem herself. She probably tried other ways. She probably gone to medical doctors, and they could not be fixed. But now she seeks to get in the presence of Jesus. Regardless to the cost. Remember, she's a woman. She's a Gentile. She's a Canaanite. And now she's going into the presence of Jesus. As a matter of fact, the disciples were tripping. She calling after us. She calling. She ain't calling not one disciple's name. She talking to Jesus. Told y'all it ain't that deep. She wasn't trying to talk to the armor bearer. She trying to talk to Jesus. They all up in the way. She calling after us. Let's just send her away, Jesus. She tripping. What? No. She ain't even talking to you. We've got to quit talking to folk to get to Jesus and just go straight to. Listen. Man, I don't know where this is going, but here it is. I love all y'all. I do. I'll pray for all y'all. Pray for your families, pray for your children, but you should not be dependent upon the pastor praying for you because you may call me and can't get me. You need to have a prayer life. You need to have a relationship that says, I thank God for my pastor. I thank God that he prays for me, but when I can't get him and he ain't praying for me, I have the ability to go to Jesus for myself. My prayer should be supplemental. Amen? Hey, come on. Okay. All right. The other thing that drove her was love for her child. Love made her accept Jesus' silence, and yet she continued to appeal. She went to him for deliverance for her child, and he says nothing. What happens when you go to God and you don't get that immediate answer? When he doesn't respond right away, and it causes us to have to stay there and to listen. What do you do? Because she stayed there. She waited on him. She waited for her answer. Next, she had a vision. She saw Jesus' compassion, and she knew that he would not turn her away if she went to him in faith. She understood who she was. She understood what she should and should not be doing, but she also understood who she was going to talk to. And there are times in our lives when we understand that the deck may be stacked against us, that we have no standing to be going talking to who we're going to talk to, but we also understand that we serve a merciful and a loving God. And this is what I need, and so I need to voice my need. I need to put it in the atmosphere that it can be addressed. The second thing this mother did to elicit such praise from Jesus was that she persisted. She persisted. The mother refused to be put off or intimidated. She was not going to take criticism or silence for an answer. There were three intimidating factors that could have kept her from being persistent. The silence of Jesus. In verse 23, she didn't perceive it as indifference. She just reached beyond it and spoke to his heart. She didn't fall out in the floor because he didn't answer immediately, because he didn't have anything to say, but she kept reaching. She kept going. She kept digging. She kept going forward because she knew if anybody could help her child, if anybody could help her child, it had to be Jesus. Next, the rebuke of the disciples. She didn't deal with them. She didn't go with them. I ain't talking to you. She, you know, y'all know, wasn't no neck popping, hands on hips. She just went above them to the source. Sometimes you just got to alleviate some people in the process and go to the source. Too often we're guilty of dealing with folk in the process when they're not the source or the resource. But then there was the behavior of Jesus in verse 24. What he said, in effect, was, sorry, madam, but you don't belong to the right group. You have no claim on me, because he had been sent here for the Jews. You follow me? Okay, while I'm here, let me work on this piece. He talks about the blessings of God's children being thrown to dogs. You got to get into Greek, but just so you understand, the statement, it's not dogs like we think of dogs chained up out at the tree, vicious, wild-running dogs, but these were house pets. These were small dogs that were controlled and kept in the house. And basically what he's saying is they were subservient to the Jewish people. That's all. He ain't calling them no Doberman Pinscher, no Rottweiler. No, he's saying those people were subservient to the Jewish people. But even in that, she was not swayed. Even in that, she kept on task. Too often we allow statements and people and expressions to pull us off task. But if God has given you a task, you got to man that task. And regardless of what's happening in front of your eyes, you've got to see the finished product. She didn't try to analyze his response. She simply refused to be put off. She let her need speak for itself. She fell at his feet and says, help me, sir. This is the essence of great faith, that you don't give up, that you keep pushing in the face of trials and tribulations and circumstances. You've got to keep pushing forward. And there may be a couple of mothers in here who will witness that you've had to live that testimony, that you've had to keep pushing. Maybe you were by yourself, or maybe there wasn't enough food, or whatever was going on in the home front, but you determined you would keep moving forward, because when you looked to your left and your right, there were children there, and you understood that if anybody was going to be a blessing in their lives, it had to be you. You can't give up. When the odds are against you, you can't give up. When the deck is stacked against you, you can't give up. You have to make up in your mind that you're going to get to where God has called you to get to. One of the greatest examples of this happened this past February. Hyvon Injatec, she is a distance runner. She was a marathon runner. Was running the Austin Marathon. 26.2 miles she was running. And for the majority of the race, she was ahead. But at about 2/10 of a mile from the finish line, she began to lose her bearing. It's now she's no longer running straight. She's wobbling. She's going back and forth. And she comes in sight of the finish line, and she falls. Medical staff runs out, and they're preparing to assist her. But the rules of a marathon is if you receive any assistance crossing the finish line, you are disqualified. So they're standing, and they're asking her, is she okay? Does she need help? This woman is down on her hands and knees. Elbows are bloody. Knees are bloody. She crawled the last 0.2 miles to cross the finish line because she said she had trained to finish, so whatever it took, she was going to finish. Can I help you? That's the determination of a mother. That whatever's going on with my child, I'm going to get them to where they need to be. There are mothers who have sacrificed to get children into college. There are mothers who have sacrificed to help children get jobs. There are mothers who have made awesome sacrifices because nobody was able to do it but you. I love my mother. She was an awesome woman. Till the day she went home to be with the Lord last May, there were certain things I still didn't say or think if I was in arm's reach of her. And she's about this tall. Old school, don't play. If I can't reach you, I'll throw something at you. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I was a daddy's boy. My dad and I were both veterans. My dad and I both loved to fish, both loved to hunt. I was a daddy's boy. I was a daddy's boy, but there were certain things that happened. I'd run straight to mom. I gave somebody's secret away right there. Run straight to any, look, anything I thought he would say no to. Mom, did you talk to your daddy? No, ma'am. All right, I'll talk to him. But here's when I knew I was in trouble. Well, go ask your father. You gonna leave me out there like that? For real? Yeah. And as much as I love my dad, and we spent time together. There were some things that happened in my life. There were some things I went through. There were some things I desired. I went straight to mama. There's some more witnesses in here that there's something special about a mother. There's something about a mother that prays. There's something about a mother that lays her hands on you. There's something about a mother who takes care of us even when we are grown. She was persistent. She had dogged determination that only a mother could possess. Y'all know I shared in one sermon about the running back that runs for that team with the star. I won't say that name. Emmitt Smith, who is the leading yard gainer in NFL history. And the thing about Emmitt, he never had true breakaway speed. He was never flashy as Barry Sanders or Walter Payton. But that joker kept running no matter what. That is the determination that a mother has. Regardless of what's going on, regardless of what's happening, they keep moving forward for their children. And can I really help you? Sometimes they're moving forward dragging their children. Oh, y'all, come on. Y'all know we didn't want to go. We didn't want to participate. How many of us had to be in the little Easter presentation? Come on, get your hands up. You didn't want to be up there saying that. Tell your mama you weren't going to do it. That's why all of us were right up there. But you know what? We're all better people because we were right up there.
Yeah.
Washington Irving says, the love of a mother is never exhausted. It never changes. It never tires. It endures through all. A good repute in bad repute. In the face of the world's condemnation, a mother's love still lives on. We see that. We see that even as criminals are convicted of heinous crimes. But their mother is still there. Because there is a bond that cannot be broke. That's mama and child. Right or wrong, that's mama and child. Amen, amen. Persistence is the hallmark of godly motherhood. But thirdly, I'm going to take my seat. The cause Jesus to praise her was she made no claim. Verse 27, she relied on the grace of Jesus. When our Lord told her that it didn't seem right to take bread from the children of Israel and to throw it to the little dogs of the Gentiles, she didn't burst into tears. She did not walk away, but instead she gave Jesus an answer that must have excited him. She said, "True, sir, I admit I have no claim to you, but there must be some grace somewhere, some grace that I don't deserve. And I'm appealing to that right now." No wonder Jesus replied to the woman, "You have great faith." No wonder from that moment her daughter was made whole. This mother possessed great faith because she won over difficulties. She won over the devil. Every obstacle and opposition that may have conquered her, she broke through it by faith. So I need you this morning to not despair when you're faced with a problem, but I need you to cross your barriers. I need you to push your way to Jesus. I need you to be persistent in your belief, even in the midst of darkness, when you don't know how it's going to work out. I need you to be persistent. I need you to keep pushing. I need you to keep calling on the name of Jesus. And then you will receive his grace. You will receive his love because he offers it so freely. So this morning, whether you are a mother, whether you're a father, whether you're a sister, or whether you're a brother, I need you to know that you need to have great faith. Regardless of what happens in your life, if you keep your faith locked on Jesus Christ, he will raise you up. Yeah, there are times you'll go down. There are times folk will walk away and leave you for dead. There may be times when you think you're dying yourself. But we serve a God who has resurrection power. And all he has to do is speak one word, and everything in your life will change. We have to be faithful. Faithful in our belief. We can't believe it as long as it's comfortable. But we have to be faithful in the face of opposition. Faithful when we're the only one standing on that side. I shared it last Sunday, and I don't know if this is dropped on me again. There are folk in countries who are locked up for carrying Bibles. The folk who want to praise God have to praise God in cellars and in back rooms.
Chapel Baptist Church, located at 3911 Dickey Mill Road in Mevin, North Carolina, where the pastor is Pastor Scotty Terrain, preaching a powerful message that will definitely bless your heart and soul. The church vision is impacting, transforming, and empowering people's lives for victorious living. Yes, this church designed for you in mind. Well, the pastor is Pastor Scotty Terrain, preaching a powerful message every Sunday morning. Yes, the church location is 3911 Dickey Mill Road in Mevin, North Carolina. The telephone number for prayer, information, or directions is 578-1450. Make sure you come out to this awesome church where the pastor is Pastor Scotty Terrain of Miles Chapel Baptist Church, located again at 3911 Dickey Mill Road in Mevin, North Carolina. Now, thank you so much for watching, and may God continue to richly bless you.